regarding catechism. There is catechism for the adults usually after Mass every Sunday here. But the next catechism will be in 3 weeks, both for adults and for the children. When there is no catechism for children on Sundays, the children are expected to be here with the adults to attend the catechism. And the adults also are expected to remain here after Mass for the catechism. Therefore, after 3 weeks, we will resume the catechism both for adults and children as usual. Those who are unable to attend the Sunday catechism due to some good reasons, better to inform beforehand or afterwards that they are not able to attend. But all those who are coming for Sunday Mass must in a way prepared to be here for the catechism also, because that is one of the obligations of the obligation days of the Catholic Church. The Holy Gospel according to Saint Luke. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and Philip his brother tetrarch of Iturea and the countries of Trachonitis, and Lysanias tetrarch of Abilene, under the high priests Annas and Caiaphas. The word of the Lord came to John, the son of Zachary, in the desert. And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of penance for the remission of sins. And it is written in the book of the sayings of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight his paths. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be brought low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways plain, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. Dearly beloved brethren in Jesus Christ, Catholic Christians prepare the way of the Lord chiefly during this season of Christmas by removing from their soul all that can impede the coming of Christ, both in history and in the sacraments. Hence the proximate preparation for the feast of Christmas, as said in today's Gospel, consists in filling every valley, bringing low every mountain and hill, making straight the crooked and make the rough ways plain, so that every flesh shall see the salvation of God. First, filling up of the deep valleys of ungodliness and sensuality, the deep valleys of slothfulness and indifference to our religious duties, and the gutters of sensuality must be filled with zeal for souls, frequent reception of the sacraments, and devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Second, bringing low the high mountains of pride and vanity. The high mountains of pride and vanity of self-complacency and worldly ambitions must be brought low by humility, detachment, and penance. Third, smoothing the rough grounds of unguardedness and jealousy. The smoothing of rough ground of jealousy and envy, hatred and uncharitableness must be done by helping the poor, visiting the sick, and comforting the afflicted. Fourth, straightening the crooked path of dishonesty and deceit. The straightening of the crooked paths of our habit of falsehood, detraction, calumny, and causing injustice, and this kind of twisted, devious, and perverse way of life must be by all means straightened by sincere confession and straightforward behavior. Thus, my dear brethren, we have to prepare the way of the Lord, and after preparation, when and if the Lord comes, where are we to lodge Him? What dwelling are we to offer Him? That is the question we must ask seriously today as a proximate preparation for the birth of our Lord in our soul and in our life. It is our heart we must offer Him as His dwelling place, a permanent dwelling place, of course. But do we not know that our hearts are so impure, so unworthy of His divine majesty? What then are we to do to take and make our hearts worthy of His coming and dwelling in us? There is a great advice given by Saint Louis de Montfort, the admirable secret of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Let us take Mary, he says, and this good mistress will give herself to us in a real manner, and then the eternal incarnate wisdom, Jesus, will come and dwell in that immaculate manger in our heart. So the immaculate manger, Our Lady, must be given a place permanently in our heart if we want to become well prepared for the coming and dwelling of Jesus in us. How happy is the man who dwells in the house of Mary, where Jesus was the first to come and dwell, to make this ideal preparation for the feast of Christmas. We are called first to entrust our body and our soul in the hands of Mary to be sanctified. A very good example has been portrayed in the Old Testament. Jacob, the son of Isaac, the younger son, of course, he brought to his mother Rebecca two young goats. We, the children of Mary, also must bring our body and our soul with all our faculties to the Blessed Virgin Mary, that she may accept us as her own, that she may, by divesting us of self-love, make us die to sin and to self, that she may cleanse our body and souls from every stain of inordinate affection and guile, that she may clothe us with her own virtues and graces according to the Heavenly Father's taste and for His great glory, that she may present us before God as deserving of His blessing, exactly like Rebecca making her son Jacob deserving for the blessings of his father before he died. Secondly, we are called to be obedient to Mary and to follow her advice in everything. Here we are simply following the example set by our Lord Himself, who spent 33 years glorifying God in perfect and entire submission to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Jacob received his blessing through the obedience to the advice of his mother Rebecca, as Jesus at Cana. As a reward for following the advice of Our Lady, water was changed into wine. The great miracle of our own souls to be changed into sanctifying grace from sinful state, our Blessed Mother's advice and help is very much necessary, that we must contemplate regularly. In the same way, all who are to receive the wondrous graces of God during this Christmas season will receive them only as a result of their perfect obedience to Mary. But on the other hand, the elder sons, like that of Esau, who are called now Protestants, will lose their blessings because of their lack of devotion or submission to the Blessed Virgin Mary. This is a typical example. The elder son Esau was like Protestants. He did not want to be with his mother, did not want to hear her advice and guidance, and therefore lost the blessings of his father. Likewise, the Protestants who have denied willfully and permanently their submission to the Blessed Virgin Mary, because of that, they have lost the grace of the real presence of the Blessed Sacrament, which is most important for all those who want to go to heaven. They do not believe. They don't want to believe the real presence of the Blessed Sacrament, Jesus incarnate. Jesus incarnate is given only to those who submit themselves to the Blessed Virgin Mary with a filial tender devotion to her. If at all we are induced to be tempted, like the Protestants, to set aside the devotion of the Blessed Virgin Mary, we must be very, very careful. we will lose all the blessings of the incarnate wisdom, Jesus born in Bethlehem. Thirdly, by hiding and losing ourselves in Mary, we taste the sweetness of Jesus. We have great confidence in the goodness and power of Mary. We rely on her mercy and kindness to obtain forgiveness of our sins. Even to obtain forgiveness of sins, we need our Blessed Mother's mercy and kindness. Because with or without our knowledge, she always intercedes for sinners towards Jesus Christ, chiefly when they approach the sacrament of penance. We experience her motherly comfort in our troubles and anxieties. We even cast ourselves into her virginal bosom, hide and lose ourselves there, and are filled with pure love. Thus we are purified from the least stain of sin through the sacrament of penance, of course. And we find Jesus in all his fullness because of this guidance of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Sinners, on the other hand, deplorably choose to satisfy their hunger elsewhere, outside the hands of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Because, as St. Gregory says, they do not want to taste the sweetness already prepared within themselves, within Jesus and Mary. But we are happy in imitating the virtues of the Blessed Virgin Mary for this purpose. Happy are those who keep my ways. The words of Proverbs 8:32. Happy are those who keep my ways. What does it mean? Happy are those who practice the virtues of the Blessed Virgin Mary. We must know at least few of the virtues of the Blessed Virgin Mary. The Church teaches to us, giving 10 principal virtues of the Blessed Virgin Mary. At least try to know a few of them by heart. Profound humility, lively faith, blind obedience, continual mental prayer, mortification in all things, ardent charity, heroic patience, angelic sweetness, divine wisdom, and the last, virginal purity. The last is not the least. You must always ask for this virtue to the Blessed Virgin Mary continuously. Virginal purity. Happy are those who practice the virtue of the Blessed Virgin in this world. Because of the abundance of grace and sweetness which Our Lady imparts to them, out of her fullness of grace, fullness of divinity, fullness of divine maternity, they are happy to celebrate the Christmas with a supernatural joy. Because they receive the Christian Christmas grace more abundantly than others who do not imitate Our Lady so closely. They will be happy for all eternity, because no servant of Mary who imitated her virtue during life has ever been lost. Let us therefore not say like those people of Bethlehem, that there is no place for Mary in our home. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.